Hello, coffee drinkers. Cannot tell you how good it feels to be back on the couch and practicing. It's really so different, the mode of being home and the mode of being on tour, and the irony of playing so much music on tour but never practicing at all, like being probably too exhausted or just not having the time, you know, when there are a few hours here and there, probably also not wanting to even look at the bass or touch the bass. But that's a very different feeling when I get home. And I get to kind of go back and listen to a few of the ideas and you know, kind of review some of the shows from the tour and work on those melodies. There is one melody in particular, and that's why today's vlog is entitled Developing and Reharming a Melody, because I started going from Poet's Walk. I started going from Poet's Walk, which is in B flat minor, and playing kind of the melody all the way through. But on the record, after the main melody gets done, I kind of put in a little, I put in like a chord sequence into the looper, and then solo over that. But I went always looking to change things like that, and I did that in real time on the road. I just thought, okay, I'm not gonna go there, and I went to this. I went to this kind of B flat pedal with a little bit of a higher tempo, and this happened in Toulouse. This happened on the show in the south of France in Toulouse. I remember it very well. And I came up with this new melody. So if you saw any of the other vlogs, like after Toulouse, I did put some footage of that kind of song starting to develop. I put that in a couple of times towards the end of the tour because it really was starting to develop. I was using a lot of percussive effects for the purpose of the live performance, and really kind of pushing the limits of what I could do with the bass and trying to find as many new sounds as possible. On the very last show in Biel in Switzerland, I managed to find this kind of cajon sound, like the snares in a cajon. I managed to find that sound with the Franta bit on degrade mode. I forget the settings even, but I put that in a vlog like a couple of days ago, so you can check that out, the one from Switzerland, from Biel. And I liked the melody. It really came up as a complete melody. It was, of course, in the middle of an improvisation in this initially when I was in Toulouse, but it ended up being. And then I played it again. Like, immediately, I dug the idea and I repeated it. And there are a couple of variations of it, but the seed was planted. And because I developed that idea in real time on the gig, from an improvisation into more of a compositional thing, I don't know what you would, yeah, just more into more of a tune, into more of a melody, something that was repeated, something that I ended up. Something that I ended up kind of harmonizing, adding a harmony part to the melody, and that ended up developing through the last half of the tour. Now, I've been thinking about that melody. I've been listening to it every day as I've played it, when I've reviewed it in the gig footage afterwards, and I've been wanting to do something a little more with it. And when I was sound checking in Biel, I came up with a little chord sequence. D flat to C diminished, E flat, A, and then B minor, B flat minor to A flat to G flat, and the melody. So that all works great over the pedal. Everything works great over the pedal. That's how I'd been playing it the entire time until I got to BL. Even that night in BL, I didn't use that chord sequence. But again, it was just planting the seed for a future date, which is today, because I finally got my bass. As you can see, I got my bass and my pedals back after the airline lost them. Thankfully, it was on the way home. I didn't need them. And I'm still pretty amazed that I got through the whole trip with all of those flights, 20 or more flights. I don't know, it was a lot of flights and just a lot of moving around in general, and all the bags and the bass, most importantly, stayed with me. So all good, got the gear back, not too much drama, but today's really the first time after the craziness of, you know, being home the first 2 days and having really a lot to do and getting a new car and getting back in the gym and kind of getting back on my routine. Today's really the first day, what are we, the 2.5 days I've been home. So today is like the first day of really being able to practice, and that thing's been in my mind. So I now have this chord sequence, and it probably won't stop there. Like, that's just my, of course, that now I have a new chord sequence to improvise over, and also to get in and out of the melody. That's another exercise or kind of test I set myself, like how familiar am I with the melody? Like, how much is that melody so inside my playing that I can get back to the melody at any point? You know, the melody I think is maybe 8 bars long. Can I get back in the end of the 4th bar to the melody from an improvisation? Like, how much confidence do I have in my ability to play that melody? That's always a great test. That's always been a great one for me. And it's, you know, it sounds really simple, like how well can you play a melody? It's especially simple if you wrote the melody yourself. You know, how easy should that be by rights? But that ability to have it, to call it back at any point and reference the melody, that's where I become really in control of form. I think that's where a lot of us can be way more in control of form than we are, is by knowing the melody. You know, it's not just about knowing the chord changes and where the 2-5-1s are and the cadences and the strong parts and the weak, all those things. Really, the melody is so, so important. And, you know, reharmonizing it, great exercise. I mean, I'm thinking compositionally here because I kind of want to develop this into a longer song. But being able to play that, whether it's over a vamp or whether it's over a set of chord changes, and be able to weave in and out of the melody from improvised material back to the melody is huge. And that really helps me come up with better melodies in future as well. Like, and the repetition of certain ideas as well. It, you know, that's how this whole song, as embryonic as it is in terms of the stage of development, that's how this start of this song came about, was by having a really melodic improvisational idea and then really sticking with that idea. You've heard me talk about change and repetition. Those are basically the only two things I'm conscious of when I'm improvising, when I'm playing, is a change and repetition. You know, do I find a nice, do I have a nice phrase and should I repeat that? Should I really work on that and develop that? Or have you heard that so many times, or have I heard that so many times, or do I feel the audience has heard it so many times that it is time to change? So it's repetition or change. And when I heard this melody, and it's not a 4-note phrase by any means, it's like an 8-bar, full-on A section melody to a tune as far as I'm concerned. So that the ability to be able to take that phrase immediately, especially as I'd never played it before, the ability to be able to take that phrase and immediately repeat it and remember it through over the course of 5 minutes or so really helped me in terms of that performance. So that made that performance so much more cohesive and kind of easier for the audience to follow, and then something that everyone was able to take away from it at the end, including me. You know, like, not only were the audience probably able to take away fragments of that melody and be able to sing them, but I was able to take that away and develop it for the next 2 weeks on the road and really like get so much mileage out of it, to the point where here I am reharmonizing it and developing it into a composition, you know, really developing that idea and getting the most out of it that I possibly can. So there you heard, I hope you heard that, repeated a bunch of times, some kind of transitional material in between, but that was the basic idea. And then towards the end of it, I found a new simple phrase. So we had. Basic shape. And the ability to move that basic shape around the instrument and through the harmony. All of that is practicing things diatonically, shapes and patterns and phrases, and really working on that in your practice routine. And then being able to shift between them. So I went from to. And already my brain is telling me, change. That was too much repetition. And sometimes I'll work through form after form after form with the same idea, building tension with a simple 2-3-4 note phrase, repeating it over and over again. That's a lot more effective to me anyway when I have a band, and that band can react to the repetition and they can build tension around it as well before we kind of have this common goal of like, where is the release? Like, where are we gonna get out of this? And sometimes that's completely intuitive and my eyes will be closed and, you know, I'll give maybe a fraction of a cue before I go somewhere else and the whole band will release into that. And sometimes that's a visual cue. Sometimes that's like we're all looking at each other kind of smiling like, okay, we're on the same page. We're going in the right direction. We're building this thing. And then one of us will give a head cue or a like, let's go, or come on, or a verbal thing, whatever it is. And then we'll really release that tension and move into the next, you know, next exploration of the improvisation. So really, really just cool things to be aware of. And these are the kind of things that I become aware of the more I play my own music on the road. And these are the kind of things I get to come home and then develop and work into compositions and increase my repertoire, increase my vocabulary, maintain my ability to be that fluid in terms of all of these concepts and how I move through them and how I approach improvisation and just how I approach performance in general, whether it's solo, as I've been playing more recently, or whether it's a band situation, like next week, I have another gig with Bob and Roslyn and Sean and the guys at the Baked Potato, our monthly thing in LA, and that's gonna obviously be a little bit of a different approach, but still with a common goal of melody and time and sound and kind of this common appreciation for the shape of the music. I think that's really important. And when you get four people on the same page, which I think this band is now with Bob, like we've played so much together that we kind of get on the same page, dynamically speaking, and have the ability and the power to go in so many directions. I'm really looking forward to this gig, I gotta say. Like, having not played with another musician in a really long time, I'm really looking forward to this gig. And maybe I'll get to take this song, you know, And I can develop maybe another section. You know, I think that's my goal for today, is to find a B section. Maybe we go another A with some harmony. So maybe maybe that's the that last phrase is something that I then develop into the next section. Who knows? I like that. And this is just totally improvising. This is just literally playing the next thing that I hear in my head. This is not using theory or do I want to go to the next section and make this kind of cadence or does this plagal thing or perfect thing or enharmonic equivalent. None of that stuff enters my mind. You could analyze it afterwards as I went to the form. I have to even think about what it was. Yeah, so I did go to the 4 minor, to the E flat. And then I kind of, but really it's just the melody and then I'm developing that melody and having these like natural harmonic instincts just because I've played so many combinations of chords in my life and listened to so much music and been immersed in great harmony and in jazz harmony and classical harmony and really, really listened and really learned about, you know, the fluidity that you need and the amount of hours that you need to practice that stuff, really the basic stuff. You've all seen me talk about minor triads and their inversions, major triads and their inversions. It's that stuff, that simple stuff that gives me the ability to go because all those are a triad that I'm harmonizing this with. And you know, the whole 10th relationship with the root note, or a lot of these. You know, you've heard me talk about this so much. I talk about it on VBL so much, videobasedlessons.tv, so many harmony and chord courses on that site. And it really, the development and the evolution of how I play that and how I hear it. But it's not complicated, it is just thousands and thousands of hours of really working on that stuff, so that really, as I said before, it's not theory based. It would the way I'm approaching this next section of the music is literally playing the first melody that came to mind, which is literally melody driven, not theory driven. You know, it's so important to get away from the theory driven process. I cannot stress that enough. It's all well and good being able to analyze it afterwards, to verbalize it to someone else, to explain it to another musician, but the process, the literal real-time process that you've just seen. You know, before I started filming, I had this, I had that melody already. What I didn't have was, didn't have any of that yet. So that's happened in the last 5 minutes, literally from melody, from being as far away from theory and analysis and all of that stuff, being as far away from that as possible. That's where that's come from. So today's vlog ended up being a little bit multifaceted in terms of, yes, we're looking at melody and how to reharmonize that and develop it, but also at the process and how I do that, how I'm very passionate about teaching that. You know, of course, everyone works differently, but there is a common kind of understanding and a common thread to when I talk with great musicians about this, that without fail, everyone has the same reaction and the same answer and such a similar concept of they're not thinking about harmony and they're not thinking about theory when they play. They are just creating. As a result of having spent so many hours working on the fundamentals and working on the basics, just like we all did as infants learning our native language, we just spent so long immersed in the very basics that we picked it up and we were able to formulate basic vocabulary and communication. And that was not theory-based, and neither is this. So I hope that's a great example of that. I hope that's something for you to think about and perhaps, you know, rip off. Like, take that melody, play around with that melody. I'd love to see some other results of reharmonizations of that melody. That would be cool. Because everyone hears it differently, you know what I mean? Like, you know, I came up with this. Pretty straightforward, diatonic, almost classical sounding harmony. I'm sure, there are 100 people out there watching this, 1,000 people, 10,000 people that would come up with 10,000 completely different versions of this. So that would be super interesting. I mean, maybe there's a way people can post some videos of that and maybe tag the vlog or tag Hello Coffee Drinkers or something so I see it, you know, so I can, when I search those tags, then the videos would come up. I don't know, but maybe you guys can come up with a hashtag that we can use. Let's come up with a communication hashtag for this channel so that if anyone wants to post a video and have it seen by everyone else, we should have a unique hashtag. So somebody come up with that, or a bunch of people come up with it. Let's get some comments below and let's start that happening. It'd be great to throw melodies out there and ideas and hear everyone else's, you know, take on it, because we think so differently. I think that would be super interesting. Anyway, today's vlog is already super long. It is very much done, and I'm gonna get back to working on this B section. Anyways, you see how it goes. Could be here all night. But today's vlog is done. I will see you guys tomorrow. Do do do.